get right to it unless there's something that I'm probably have to do. Approval of minutes, so we have, only one meeting this time. October 17th, we have a motion for approval.
Motion.
Second?
Second.
And any discussion, changes? All in favor?
Yes.
Opposed? Okay. District treasurer's report, ready to component to this. The school tax report, month report for September and October, quarterly revenue report, and budget calendar, which I guess we are, see that later, do you know?
Yes.
I have a motion from the poll. Second?
Second.
Any questions or discussion?
Just to point out, the budget calendar follows historically what we've done. So, that process.
And, it looks like you have a little bit more in here, maybe like.
Yes. We had those last year, but they're very vague, very, it's that big presentation, we just talked about the budget, the preparation of the budget. So that was like in January.
Yep.
We talked about projections, and what the projections, the parameters to be, which normally we try to remain within the tax cap limit in the past.
Yep.
And then, so the next one is the preliminary budget forecast and budget assumptions. As we roll over with current information, we give you a quick snapshot. But remember, we don't have any of the state aid numbers yet, so everything's so preliminary at that point that it's difficult to project a lot other than what we know for the expenses. And then, let's see, the next one is the 13th, and that was normal. We did do that, we talked about line by line what was in the budget.
Yep.
And what we're projecting in the budget in those areas. Now, on the, actually, on the 13th, last year I was looking back, we combined the 13th and the 20th together. I'm not sure how that'll end out this year. We had planned on having that initial meeting, but we didn't have anything new to discuss.
Yep, okay, but at least we have it just in case.
Yeah, sometimes it seems rushed during that period, and we want that extra meeting, so. Okay, or?
And then the 27th, and there's usually a lot, and then.
We review the whole budget package, and by then we should have our revenues from the state, and so we give you the whole projection, you have the tax levy and everything. And then in April is when, the April 11th, which is an additional meeting, because the, your April meeting is late in the year. So we're having it at the April 11th, so we have time to get the budget newsletters and items out to others prior to the budget hearing.
Any issues with the taxes?
No, taxes were fine, there, it was almost the exact amount collected last year as this year.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Denise does a good job.
Okay, all in favor?
Yes.
Opposed? Okay, 1.5, building use requests, we have the Twin Town Warriors for practice on Friday, so we have a motion. Second?
Second.
Questions? This is a chargeable one. Always good. All in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
Opposed? 1.6, communications to the Board of Education, and we've had several. Edward Fitzgerald sent an email regarding the Dr. Finkel settlement agreement. And it was regarding the dates and the terms incorporated in the agreement, which I believe Amanda wrote a very positive email, which is nice to get. Situation arose that Mr. Warwick and Amy Murphy, so commending them for a situation that they handled, which is great to hear. Anybody receive any others?
No.
And I know maybe it's a good time to bring it up, emails, so you wanted to talk about...
Yeah, well, I kind of have that in my, when we, the 1.9, and I have to apologize, because I didn't get here early enough to fill Andrea in on that. But I kind of have it in that, but if you want to talk about that, we can.
Nope, that's fine.
You sure?
Yep.
Okay. Just too down. So it's not too far.
Okay. 1.7, resignation with regret, of course, for board member Christina Curran. And as you know, Christina's had been absent really for quite some time with health issues. And she finally has decided, with thinking about it very long and hard, because I think all this time she really has intended to come back. But she met with Ann and I and really has thought long and hard and feels that her recovery is taking a little bit longer and really feels that it'd be in the best interest of her, her family, as well as the board of the district that she resigned. So I actually do have, I think...
It is in here, but it's towards the bottom.
Oh, to accept?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's what I read in there.
Yeah. Dear members of the Board of Education, after discussions with my family and with a heavy heart, I have decided to resign from the Winnetka Board of Education effective December 31st, 2013. Due to personal reasons, I no longer have the time and energy needed to fulfill my responsibilities to the board, Garber Dickinson, and the community. This decision was not made lightly. As you know, I have dedicated almost 8 years to my position on the board, in addition to time with shared decision-making and all the volunteer hours I spent with PTO functions and classroom activities while my children went to Garber Dickinson. It is my hope this empty seat will be an opportunity for someone who desires to be a part of an incredible team and the exciting future of PD. I would like to thank the Board of Education and the entire Winnetka community for allowing me the opportunity to serve on the board and work together to continue improving education for our children. Yep, that sounds like a good idea, and I don't know if we will be actually, so for those that may be interested, or spread it around, please, but we will be doing a press release to announce the fact that there is a board seat available and how that works, and please, everybody jump in if I miss something. But basically, the board seat will become available, and the board will appoint someone through the end of this year. So even though Christina's term is actually through 2015, we will only appoint through the end of this year. And then someone will need to run during the next voting process, and that person will be voted in for the end, through the end of that term. So we are hoping...
The end of Christina's term.
Correct.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
We are hoping that we'll have multiple people interested. And if we do, what we'd like to do is basically an interview process. And we're not quite sure of that. I think we're leaning towards doing that publicly. So a public interview process, either right before the meeting or maybe a week before the meeting, depending on how the timing works. So applications will be due, I think.
Just changed it. It's why we put it in the advertiser said to go back to the
We are.
The applications are immediate, but the votes may be just the week before.
Okay, so that doesn't give us a lot of time.
No.
But, okay. So that is how that will work, and then the board will basically make that decision, but it will only, again, be through the end of this year. So.
I know that we wanted to talk a little bit about the duties and responsibilities.
I'm not sure when.
Yeah, I was going to say, can we get into a little bit of that tonight?
that's right from your policy.
Do you guys have that?
I have one.
Is it all?
Yeah, do we want to read it? I know that we had talked about, and we haven't had a heck of a lot of time since we've gotten word from Christina, is just to kind of fill people in on what does a board member do, and if you've got questions, and you want to ask us questions, what your responsibilities are, what your responsibilities are not. Are we going to try to set up something between now and the next meeting to do that? I don't know if we necessarily have time to see it.
I think we're going to start talking about it at this meeting, and then probably whoever's interested in questions do that. I don't know that we have another meeting to send.
Right.
So we can start talking about it at this meeting and then answer questions.
And I have to apologize, because I didn't get here early enough to.
Okay.
If we were going to, both Andrea and I had comments, so I'm sorry.
So this is our policy regarding board legal status. The Board of Education is a 5-member board elected by the district residents. Each member of the board serves 3 years. The terms of office of board members shall not expire in the same year. Board members are responsible for school district management and policy making. The legal status of the board is that of a corporate body established pursuant to the laws of New York State. Any liability of the district is a liability of the Board of Education as a corporation, and not that of members of the board as individuals. Members of the Board of Education have legal authority for the conduct of the district only when acting as a body in a properly convened session. Board members acting as individuals have no authority over personnel or school affairs. The board will not be bound in any way by any individual statement or action unless the board, through an adopted policy or by a majority vote of the board membership, has delegated this authority to an individual member. The board is entrusted with the responsibility of developing policies under which the district is managed. In addition, the board has all the powers and duties stated in the education law and other applicable New York State law. Complete and final authority on all district educational matters, except as restricted by law, will be vested in the board. So that's the formal piece of it.
That's the legal part of it.
But I don't know if anybody wants to talk about, you know, obviously there's some time commitment, which you all saw a little bit of the, probably the largest time commitment there could be possible. And also during budget process, there's a lot of time, but I don't know if anybody wants to talk about their experience or.
Mostly been positive. You say there's a large time commitment. We realize how much time we needed. Have we given? I don't know if my wife is so happy with it, but.
Yeah, I've talked to quite a few parents this year over the course of the summer. I got to be honest with some of the PTO members out here. I came from being president of PTO, and this was not as much time. So anybody that was a president of PTO can understand that. I was here all the time, and I was dragging refreshments and snacks and unloading my car, and I had a baby and what have, and 2 kids, you know, coming on the other side. So it's a different kind of time commitment, and I think I've talked to a bunch of you guys about that. I personally chose to do it because I didn't grow up in this town. I grew up in Troy. I was in a big, large school district, kind of an inner city school. And when my husband and I moved here, because my husband's on the police department, so we have to live in the town of Frankfurt. So when we lived, we were here, and I had to stay here. And when my kids started school, I just really loved the K-8 school. And I just thought it was awesome, and I thought our kids had this great foundation to go to high school. So and as my kids got older, I realized it wasn't just the K-8 kids that, we have kids in high school that are part of our district that we are making decisions for, and I just wanted to be part of, you know, making sure that our kids had the foundation to go to high school, to get into colleges, and to do all that. So. I think it's a great opportunity for anybody out there that's thinking about it. There's there's so much, you know, more than, even if your kids are, you know, in seventh and eighth grade, you're kind of like, well, they're almost out of school, and maybe I don't want to do it. There's so much more you can give back to the community. And for me personally, and I know Andrea's kids are not here any longer either, but, you know, I just think that there's just so much that you can give back. And if anybody's thinking about it, don't let the summer scare you. And we, it was a lot of time this summer. It was way more time than I ever gave to anything. But that doesn't normally happen, and there were tough times, but, you know, please don't let that shy you away. There's so much good that can be done, and we need, I mean, you know, you can see it's a lot of work for us. We need people that want to be involved, and as much as I'd love to say we're going to be here forever, or if we're not, I mean, next year will be my ninth year, and thinking, it's probably going to be it for me, but I don't know what I'll do because my daughter will go off to college. And what will I do? You know. So, but really, if you have any questions, you guys, most of you guys know how to get in touch with us, and that might lead us into the next thing. But you know, if you have any questions, if you want to ask us stuff tonight, I mean, if you want to wait for public comment and do it, if you want to give us a call, if you anything, any of us would be more than happy. I don't know, but I don't want to hog the conversation, but if you guys have anything you want to add to it, I'm more than happy to talk to anybody, and I know everybody else is here too.
I guess, you know, we all have our reasons why we got onto the board. Mine happened to be, I'm a finance person in my professional life, and mine happened to be when the school was having some real budget difficulties, and so I came on board during that time to kind of lend that piece of the expertise. But, you know, no matter what each person's reason is, I think the key to remember is that we can't really do anything without the rest of the board. So we really have to work as a team to make some of these good things happen. So, which I think we've done really well.
It definitely is an eye opener. Once you get on the board, there's lots of things that you had absolutely no idea.
It's a learning experience.
Yes. especially me, I come from private business. And when I'm now in the school business, it's a totally different thing. So, but it's great. And I think that if you guys anybody's considering it, please.
And I'm sure Lee is also a wealth of information on the topic.
Well, so. I was going to suggest that perhaps when we get the application and hopefully it's multiple, that I can set up a meeting and we can go over more specifics prior to the actual interview.
Okay. Sounds good.
So 1.9, response to the district's operational study. I think we kind of mean for this to be more of an informal discussion among the board members. Just talk about kind of where do we go from here with that. So
I have a couple of talking points that I put together, and I don't know where you want to, you guys. To talk on behalf of the whole board. We have to give a huge thank you to Mike.
He's not here tonight. No.
And the focus groups. Look, you know what, we know time commitment is tough. So it's, you know, volunteer, and you know, we know there were parents, community members, teachers, faculty, and we really, really appreciate the time that you gave. The presentation was right on target with our thoughts, and we feel very positive moving forward. Please, anybody pipe in if you want, because I don't want to, you know, speak for everybody. I wrote down a couple things. I went through the presentation a couple times. I really thought about it, and I wrote down a couple things that I just kind of wanted to bring up a little bit. One of the biggest things that I took out of it, I have like three main points, and the first one is communication. You know,
communication's always been a big thing for us. Every year we get together, we talk about communication, and I think communication is just a big thing in today's society. How can we make things better for communicating? One of the things that we think might help us a lot are the committees. We want committees, we want to be involved in committees. Unfortunately, some of the issues this year took kind of precedent over us starting the committees. If you look further into the agenda, we talk about a communication committee, and we talk about, the second one is actually strategic planning committee. We want board members to be on there to work with the parents, with the teachers, with the community members. So we feel, you know, we can form some of those committees that may increase communication a lot for us and you guys. One of the things I really want to bring up, because right after that presentation, I called Sharon and I said, what's going on with the emails? Because this has been kind of a little issue, I think, with me for a couple of years. How we get our emails, what is the process, and sometimes we think we have a plan and we're going with the plan and it just doesn't work. So we found out that we weren't getting some of our emails. So there was a glitch in some kind of computer system and we didn't get our emails for I don't know how long, a couple months maybe. We don't really know. So if anybody emailed us, I'm going to be honest with you, we didn't get some of them. So I apologize for us not getting back to you. I don't like that. I know anybody that emailed me at home, I tried to get back right away. Even if I just said, I can't really discuss that with you. But if you were emailing us here on the link on the board page, you may not have got us. And I'm really sorry, we're not sure what happened, but you don't have them.
It is
so
fixed.
It is now.
It is correct. Fixed now. So our plan was you would email us. They would go right to the board clerk. The board clerk would send them out to us that day. That wasn't happening. So,
not by board clerk.
It was a glitch. So just so you know, that's what happened. So what I want to do tonight is just kind of open it up with the four of us. Okay, how do we need kind of a better plan that we can make sure that doesn't happen again? Because we know if any of you guys were trying to reach out to us and tell us something or communicate to us, and you really wanted to communicate directly to us. You didn't want to communicate through the superintendent. You didn't want to communicate through the principal. You wanted to communicate to us. There may have been a time that we weren't getting them. So I had thought about this. One of my ideas was, and I kind of wanted to present it to the other board members, was if we talked about a little bit, and Sharon might be able to fill me up. We talked about changing the emails a little bit so that we each had a Linusville UFSD mailbox, because that they would come directly to us. We could choose to have that forwarded to our personal email if we wanted to, or it would be our responsibility to go into Linusville mailbox and check it every day. You could get us each, you could get all of us if you wanted to. And then amongst the four of us, if we appointed one person to be the communications person, that would, you know, if it was me, I'm not saying I want the job, but if it was me, I would be the person that would respond back and say, we got your email, thank you, I'll discuss it with the rest of the board, and we'll get back to you soon. That person would take the responsibility for it. Maybe it's something we do in our reorg meeting. But we need to have a plan, and you guys, you know, the parents and the teachers and community need to know that we're going to get the email. Somebody's going to respond to them. If I'm going away, I'll let somebody else know that I can't do it and they take over. I don't know if you guys have any thoughts, ideas. Do you like it? You don't like it?
With respect to email communications to the board, my concern always is our abiding by the open meeting law, so that you're always kind of walking that fine line if you are the communications person, medical. Four of us start discussing this on the phone or via email, that's a meeting that's not open to the public and could become considered a violation of the open meetings law whenever you're discussing foreign business.
how we handle emails. I mean, some emails, they may be personal to the person that's emailing it. And, you know, you may just respond with, this is the person you should go to for that concern. But if it's something that requires us to discuss it, you know, it becomes more important.
Right. Maybe we just have to be careful to, if we're discussing something, not discussing maybe the content, making a decision, it really would be, okay, where is this appropriate to handle? Kind of discussion. You know, is it just informational? We can just provide the information back, or is it something that needs to be discussed at a board meeting, in which case we wait until the next board meeting to respond that way. So you're right, I think maybe a policy, which I believe we have a policy, I'm just not sure if it discusses the word email per se. So, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I agree with that. And that's the one reason I did like the idea of using a YNSCL email, is it's not our personal email. It's, you know, I don't love, I mean, I don't mind anybody ever contacting me, but some of the school business, I don't necessarily think should be on my personal email or my work email, you know. So I like the idea of having the YNSCL email addresses. And I get what you're saying. I absolutely, some of the emails may be very simple, you know, what do I do about this? And a lot of them, I mean, I may turn around, if it was me, I may turn around and say, call Lee and say, you know, Lee, I got an email about this. Can you please call this mom, or can you please do this? Because sometimes people just don't know who to contact. But we could set a policy. And I think one of the reasons to do this is because, like I just said, we are not going to be here 5 years from now, probably. And the parents may not be the same parents 5 years from now. And I think that we just need to make sure that any future boards are getting their emails, they're feeling comfortable, there's a line of communication, they know how to communicate with everybody. I don't know, I mean, what do you want to, like, kind of work on it over the next couple of weeks and see what we can come up with?
The only thing that is cautionary would be that using the line skill, which I think is not a bad idea, have to come into it. And so you're going to have to be disciplined. I know everyone has multiple email systems going. So, yeah, so you have three of them right now.
And I have two.
So, but you really have to be disciplined to look at that, you know, regularly, so that someone doesn't write to you directly only, and that just sits there. But other than that, the other issue that I think you'd be mindful of, if there's some issue where it's something gets subpoenaed, potential is subpoenaing all of your emails in your personal report, as they may go through it. So there's a value in keeping it in mind. So
and I thought about that because, you know, I work in a dental office and I bow my HIPAA law. So,
yeah.
You know, I really wouldn't want my work emails
sure.
to have a problem.
But
so.
We could get back to you in possible scenarios and do research.
I just have to say, I do like the idea of one link going to all board members. So whether
it's
a UFSD,
like
having the option of emailing us individually or all board members. If, you know, because it could just be a question that they just want to answer.
Yeah,
financial question. So that was my email. That was my email discussion. So I don't know if you guys want to, like, kind of talk about it a little bit. Maybe we have a decision by next month.
Looking for the website here, without adding asking a question about the website, which may help this communication also. If you ask them a questionnaire, they probably answer it. I know some more personal stuff you might want to go right to the board.
We are listening kind of thing. We just, you know, my concern is just the process, making sure that it's monitored quickly enough so that we're getting back to, especially, you know, investors sometimes questions can be very, you know, important, timely, need to be answered. Kind of thing, so.
Well, I mean, I think most of us right now have been on the board long enough that we kind of understand the processes. So, and I think that is, whoever's going to take the responsibility needs to make sure that we answer it, we get to the right people that we need to get to. And if it has has to wait till the next meeting for us to discuss it, then it has to, but then could at least get back to the person emailing us that, yeah, this is a board issue that we need to discuss.
I think maybe the, you know, having more people look at it, the policy, running by.
Yeah, okay.
Okay, so my next little thing, and I didn't hit everything, so, but the administration, the format of the administration, we have been discussing for quite a while about changing the administration. But with things happening over the summer, you know, obviously that kind of took precedent too. But it was right on target with what we thought about. We were happy to see that the teachers, the faculty, the parents, the community kind of thought the same way we were thinking. Unfortunately, part of being on a board, you have to realize that things don't happen quickly. As you can see, if you look further on the agenda, we have to abolish positions, we have to create positions, we have to get things approved, we have to have job duties, we have to have things posted. So it doesn't happen overnight, but we, I'm trying to think when we started talking about this, I don't know if you guys can kind of remember, at least sometime last year.
I think when we set it up, we knew that it was, you know.
Time to discussion.
Yep.
I came on.
Yeah.
And I really remember dying down much.
Right, yeah.
So you guys will see further on that we kind of will, you'll see what's going on a little bit further with the agenda. The last thing, because I know that we have a lot of presentations. The last thing I really wanted to talk about was trust. And for me, this was a big one, and I know for all of us, this is a big one. I wrote out kind of what I wanted to say, because I really kind of wanted to touch everything. But, and I think I can speak for everyone on the board, you are all 100% correct. We need trust between all of us. I mean, I would never argue that with anybody. The board, the superintendent, parents, teachers, community members, faculty, we all need to trust each other. And you can reverse that any way you want. You know, whoever has to trust who, it doesn't really matter which way you put it out there. But, you know, and it's a little hard for me, but we are all on this board because we feel so strong about giving back to our community and our children. And we're proud of this district. We're proud of the community. I think that you could never argue that with any board member that's sitting up here, how proud we are to be part of this district. We do have faith in ourselves, our administration, our parents, our community, our teachers, that moving forward, we can all use policies and procedures that are in place or that we'll put in place to prevent the tragedy from happening again. What happened this year. Nobody can deny there was a tragedy. Kids suffered, parents suffered, teachers, the board members. I mean, there's not one person in our lives that didn't suffer for this, in your lives, our lives. But we want everybody to trust everybody. I want to trust. And I know if you guys want to pipe in, I encourage you to pipe in a little bit about it. It was a big one for me when I left that meeting. I it's going to be hard for me to get past it a little bit too. So, but I think we are heading in the right direction, and we feel really positive as a board that we're heading in the right direction.
Yeah, and I think, you know, just for me personally, it is about everyone trusting everyone also. But I think, you know, we all have to show each other that. We all kind of have to prove it a little bit. And so I just look to, okay, myself, the board, how can we do our part to prove that? And I'm hoping that everyone else kind of steps up to do their parts as well. You know, come show that you know, you're keeping coming to board meetings, which is great, and voice your opinions and ask questions and, you know, in a respectful way, which everyone has been doing, which is wonderful. You know, kind of rally behind someone to step up to this board seat that we have, because that's another great way to show that, you know, people are willing to step up and kind of trust each other and get on board and act as a team. You know, we want to open up our committees to
more people to try to interact more, to just kind of be more open, have more discussion, because I think we sort of, each one of us kind of took on someone else's board seat and sort of carried on in the traditions that were set up a long time ago in terms of, you know, how the agenda's set up and what we talk about and what we're allowed to talk about in public and what we're not. And I think, you know, as time goes on, we need to make changes, and you guys are telling us we need to make changes, so we're trying to respond to that as much as we can. So I think, you know, to me, this is our responsibility to answer some of these requests from the community and the teachers on how we can do our part, and I think there's definitely things that everyone else can do too.
So that was it for me, and you know, if you guys you know, have questions at the end, please feel free to you know, come to the meetings, ask questions. If we can't answer something, we'll tell you. I mean, you know, and you know me, anybody that's had me run a meeting, you kind of know that we'll just kind of put it out there and tell you I can't answer that, but or if you call me or whatever. But please, you know, let's just kind of work forward and trust each other as a community, because I love living in this community. My kids are here, and in fact, my son is back student teaching now. So you know, he loves it so much that, you know, he's back here with your kids learning how to be a teacher. So you know, please let's all try to do our part. That's all I can say.
The only last thing I wanted to say is that we're going to use this kind of as a work plan. So it's not just, I mean, you see some things on the agenda tonight, you know, some things, you know, we talked about, I think Mike talked about at the presentation that some things were already underway. Some things are on this agenda. We're going to use it as a work plan and kind of keep going. So it will be woven into, you know, any of the committee work that we possibly can, add it to, whatever. So just wanted to bring that up. Okay.
We have really taken a lot of time to board meeting, so sorry.
Did we talk enough about the proposed administrative reorg plan, or do we want to?
We can probably go into that as we get further down. Do you want to talk about
that? No,
okay. So 2.1, district school program report, and the first thing we have is the 8th grade field trip presentation, which I know we have some kids here to present, and I apologize that it took so long to get to this part on the agenda.
Before I introduce formally the co-advisor, these four young ladies and our advisors, myself, have been working together, and they've been working with their classmates, doing all the kind of research that needs to be done to make this trip successful. But in addition to that, that they're exerting their leadership. So yesterday afternoon, they presented proposals to three faculty, K-5, that they will avail themselves and their classmates to help K-5 teachers to support students, whether it's tutoring or helping the classroom. And the only negative is that everybody responded they wanted it. So gotta get more tips from somewhere. But, so I think that's been the spirit of what the young ladies and the leadership bring. So let me introduce the co-advisor first, Lisa Hancock. You want to take it away?
Sure, thanks. Good evening. This is my first year being an 8th grade class advisor with Trace Kuchar. And we have quite an active plan this year. I have to say I've been here 9 years personally as a teacher, and the idea of going on an educational field trip of this kind is very exciting to me. I actually spent time working in Congress and as a presidential appointee, so this is like particularly exciting for me. When we proposed this idea to the kids, I gotta tell you, it took my breath away, the level of enthusiasm not only these the executive committee has, but the entire 8th grade class. And to kind of prove that point, we started a tradition, we started a fundraiser for Grandma's Pies, and I think we cleared $1,200. I mean, we sold how many pies? 300 pies? 287 pies, you're right, it was 287. And that all just kind of started, and it hasn't really stopped from there. I'm going to turn the meeting over to Ms. young ladies who are going to talk about Nation's Classroom, which is an organization that will sponsor, will take us on our trip. I've taken kids to Spain, I've taken kids to Mexico, and I can tell you as an adult and as a parent of a child who's been on these, the organization that sponsors this, that we entrust our children to, is the vital part. And when I first heard the idea that we're going to Washington, my first thing is there's no way I'm planning this trip. I don't care how many years I live there, but I because it's an awesome task, and to be responsible for kids. And Nation's Classroom seems to fit that bill really well, and I think it has a great track record with a lot of various schools. And Ichabod Crane in particular came and presented to our kids and parents their experience this fall with going to Nation's Classroom yet again this year. And they took 400 kids? 200, we're taking 40. So this should be a pretty good deal. All right, it seemed like one, sorry. But I'm gonna turn it over to our, you guys take it away.
I'm Sarah Peter Fry.
I'm Lauren
Girl.
Natalie Stoller.
I'm Joel Evans.
And we're here to talk about the trip to DC. The purpose of this trip is more than just fun, it's really educational. We go to DC the week of May 4th and 11th. It would be a bonding experience for the whole class, and I think it would be tighter, like more close than we already are. Going to DC is it's more interactive for kids to learn outside the classroom. It's, you won't. you have more experience when you go there than learning in the classroom.
And you're learning that type of stuff in history class,
yeah.
And social studies now, so we're going to take it live.
Yeah.
Right? That's really exciting.
So, we have the Congressman Tonko and Gibson that are going to be sponsoring us, and they're working to get us a private tour of the White House. Some other things we'll be doing are museums, monuments, sports theater, the 9/11 memorial, and art galleries. And as Benjamin Franklin, tell me and I forget, teach me and I may remember, and involve me and I learn.
Okay.
And I was talking about safety. The chaperones going on this trip will be Mr. Lutz, Mr. Bordick, Ms. Boucher, Ms. Hancock, and Mrs. Mitchell. And I know a big concern was that the kids wouldn't be allowed to bring cell phones, but this shouldn't really be a communication issue because the chaperones going on will always have one. And the kids will always be able to call their parents, and if they saw something they liked, just talk to them more. At night, they'll be encouraged to kind of tell about their day and keep in contact with them. And the chaperones are always also in charge of checking the bags to make sure that the kids have the right clothes and they're not just, they're not trying to steal their cell phones. And they're not stuff like that. So, and Nation's Classroom is Ms. Hancock brought up. And they are a group that Ichabod Crane had a really good experience with. And they plan like the trip down on the bus, the tour guides that we'll be doing touring with, the hall monitors in the hotels for the nighttime, make sure no kids are coming out or if anyone needs to go see the chaperones going on, that they'll be able to
contact
them. And they will also supply each kid with a wristband that has like an identification on it and an 800 number. So if any kid's separated from the group, then they'll just go to a tour guide or guide that they find, and they'll be redirected back to their group as soon as possible. And make sure all the trip goes smoothly and there's no problem.
Okay.
I'm
going to
talk about fundraising, like Ms. Hancock said. We did our first fundraiser, which was Grandma's Pies. We ended up selling 287 pies total and earning $1,200, lowering the price for each student to be $497.
From an original $529, right?
Yeah, original $529. Okay, our next fundraiser is wreaths. We're selling wreaths. Each child is going to decorate one, right?
Mm-hmm.
Each child will decorate a wreath. and on their spare time, they will write like a letter to a veteran or something for the holiday season in the downtown, because we thought that was sweet. And then on December 14th, we'll have our pancake breakfast, which is open to the public, so any of you guys could come.
Please come.
Yeah, and that's what we have so far, and then we have plenty of more fundraisers that will go out, and probably you guys will all be noticed.
Yeah, there's many fundraising ideas.
Oh, and then one that everyone loved was McTeacher Night. That is when we like practically rent out McDonald's, and our teachers would work there, and we would get a percentage of whatever was made that night.
Yeah, the teachers go and work in the kitchen, make all the food.
Yeah.
And then whatever sales McDonald's gets, we get like around a percentage.
Yeah.
Like
that.
We'll like that, yeah.
Yeah, I think that might require the help of the entire faculty, since there's only about 35
of us.
Yeah.
So you guys are welcome to come next tonight.
any questions or
I think it sounds awesome. I think it's such a great experience. You guys are really fortunate to be able to do that. And the small group is great. I mean, you guys have bonded anyways, because you're
we're
9 years. So there's always that natural bond, but to go away and experience that together before you all walk to your different high schools, it's really awesome. And please get one of you guys or anybody can get, make sure that the board gets some of your fundraiser ideas. Or what you're doing. I don't have anybody in the school. I'm really good about checking the website, and Mr. Bordick usually always fills us in, but if you get a slip to us, that will be right there. I can't miss it.
Do you sell the Christmas wreaths at the Christmas concert?
They always have some extra available. We're going to have decorating night on December 5th, and orders, I think, we just put them all in the mailboxes on Friday, but I will make sure by tomorrow and each one of our eighth graders wrote a note to each staff member in the building to ask them to participate in the fundraiser. And I was really proud of them. They wrote about 55 notes to each person that works in the building. So it was kind of neat. Yeah. So anytime we have them, so far with the fundraisers that we've done, the amount of energy and dedication of time during study hall, our study halls are buzzing with activity, trying to make sure we're getting all the mailings out and collecting the money and accounting for it. So it's a pretty fun activity. I've been having a lot of fun with these guys.
Yeah, and I feel like all students are really trying hard to help fundraise, and they're willing to participate.
The original cost was $529, and we're hopeful we can get it down to under $300 by the end of the year, and maybe less. So we're working on that. We have plans for anyone who may have an issue trying to raise that fund. We can look at ways that we can support the child. So we believe 100% of the kids are going to go.
Is there a subsidy?
Yes.
And we're definitely
talking
about that. Yes.
How many
minutes
ago?
We go down on the
5th. Tuesday night. We leave here about 9:30 p.m. and then we arrive at Washington 6 a.m. and we go directly to the Hard Rock Cafe for breakfast. And then they come back Friday.
We'll be back Friday.
Part of the reason why we don't want to get distracted with other electronic devices is because you're walking on city streets, and I just have to look out my window, and every teacher leaves for their But that's the natural thing. So we have a lot of experience. At least Nation's Classroom has a lot of experience with this. And the Ichabod Crane kids talk very eloquently about giving them an opportunity to an educational field trip to interact with each other and not be distracted. And the issue of communication, every teacher, every chaperone will have a cell phone.
and the numbers will all be published, so any child can talk to their parent or vice versa at any time. Nation's Classroom is a 24-hour program, so if a parent called the 800 number, that would go directly to their room to the floor. And they have a monitor in the corridor, so if somebody didn't feel well, they can come out and talk to the monitor and they can get us up. And they have medical services available as well. So Ichabod Crane was talking about, which I thought was interesting, how well they do it. One of the kids had did not feel well and had an accident, and you know, like internally, and so within maybe a very short period of time, they went out. They went to Aeropostale, was it?
Right. Yeah.
They bought a set of clothing, and nothing. Everything just went like normal. So that's the kind of support this tour company provides. So.
Nation's Classroom, and another thing,
it's on the
like
website.
They have the model walks around and get every like 30 minutes gives a report to one of the chaperones to make sure everything's going well. And one girl was sleepwalking and she thought she was going to be late for the bus and like ran right out her door and tried to head for the elevator. So Ichabod Crane said they'd have the monitor to stop her, she would have been right out on the street by the hotel.
And they said they